commissioners could review the agenda and let us know if there's anything else that we need to shift. I will just say quickly that I may ask that we, while we're trying to make sure that Bridge for Unity and our town councilors are able to speak, I think that I'm probably going to try to talk for just a couple of minutes first about the use of the affinity group discussions at the Amherst Regional Public Schools, at the high school at least, in order for us to see some of the things that we might be interested in doing as a point of comparison. Before we do that, we are now about 30 minutes behind where we thought we were going to be. So that makes things a little bit tricky as far as leaving things open for public comment. That said, I think that that we should still do that. And so I bring that up only in order for us to understand what the agenda looks like. Were there any other comments or statements about the agenda before we move on to approval of previous minutes?
This is Elizabeth, and since this is my last meeting, I would like just a minute at the end to, say thank you to everybody. Since I will be seeing you, I'm sure that, but I won't be a member of the commission. So I'd love to do that at the end.
We need a virtual cake. I'll create one quickly.
I'm going to come get my book. That's what I'm going to do.
Yes.
What you need to do. Okay. Any other, and that was a perfectly stated and necessary agenda addition. So thank you, Elizabeth, for that.
Matthew, I'm wondering if, since we're going to be short on time, do we need to take time to approve minutes tonight? Could we do that another time?
Yeah, I mean, the only comment that I would make on the minutes would just, because it's a vote, and the idea is that we're able to share this with the public once they're approved. So the longer we take, the less we're sharing with the public. So the February 27th minutes, if there's, instead of asking, hopefully you've had a chance to read them prior to coming to the meeting. And so we could just ask if there's a motion to approve the minutes of February 27th.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I second it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Opposed? Abstentions? All right, you're saying then. Okay. Great. Well, thank you very much. So for the June 4th, I think the only statement I'll make is with regard to 3 and dealing with the Civil War plaques, which I think we're going to get back to in a bit. I think that we stated support for the project in general. It reads for restoration and installation of the plaques. We don't know what that looks like right now. But as long as everyone understands that it means support in general for commemoration, then I think we're good.
Just to note that I received feedback from the family. I apologize for blanking on their name, but spoke and that they have been restored. That's what they said. So it's just about the installation.
Okay. No. Well, so they were restored, and then they've been sitting in storage in temporary. So there's a possibility that
they
may need.
Okay.
My guess is, and we'll talk about this a little bit later with what statement we want to make, that our full support would probably be somewhat dependent on the costs and what other options might exist for a similar commemoration. But the idea is that we do want to support commemoration and, to the extent feasible, the placement of the stones. But if that's the only that was the only tweak that I saw. Were there any other comments on the minutes of the June 4th meeting? Hearing none. Then is there a motion to approve? I guess, can we say HRC voted unanimously to support restoration and installation of the plaques as a general statement, just because we're going to be looking at a letter today. All right, so with that change, is there a motion to approve the June 4th minutes?
I make a motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Can I wasn't at the meeting, so I don't know if I can second or not.
I'll second.
Okay, all in favor? Opposed? Abstention?
Abstention because I wasn't in the meeting. That's the only reason.
All right, then that motion also carries. Okay, so now we're in the position of being able to open for public comment. And what we'll do is we'll, as necessary, try to give the 20 minutes so that we can actually hear from our people in town. And so at this point, if there are attendees who want to speak as part of the public comment, we are open for that. And so if you can raise your hand as an attendee. Right now, Lindsay Smith is doing that.
Can you just let them know that this is being recorded prior to, like there's usually an announcement statement, please?
Yes, one of the things that everyone should know is that these meetings are being recorded. So if you volunteer to speak, you are also volunteering to be recorded. If you do not wish to be recorded, then you are free not to speak. But because of how the town is handling things right now, all of these meetings are being recorded. All right, Lindsay Smith.
Recording's cool with me. Thanks for letting me know. So first, thank you all for setting this up. I appreciate the persistence and putting this together. This is my first encounter with these sorts of meetings. So I could be coming into what I'd like to request after you guys have already set up a resource for this. But there's been a lot going on in the news. We've all handled it well, I think, as to be expected. But I'm wondering if there's any sort of addressing the fairly specific relationship between law enforcement and civilians in the town of Amherst and as far outreaching as can be expected.
Okay, so during the public comment period, it's not an opportunity for us to answer. Our meeting will deal with that a little bit. But right now it's just our opportunity to listen.
Cool, okay, well, I can reframe it and just say I, among many, am fairly concerned with that specific relationship. It's definitely been on my mind recently, as it has been for many, many other people. And it's something that I don't normally jump in to reach out directly to you guys. I think you do a great job. My wife and I have been here in Amherst for about 5 years. But this is something that definitely hits close to home for a lot of people. And I felt the need to speak up. So here I am.
Thank you very much. And again, our agenda will discuss having conversations and Human Rights Commission involvement, including with the Amherst Police Department. So we will be reporting on that.
Sounds good.
Anyone else? I think a number of our attendees are here to speak on particular issues and therefore have space on the agenda. And so that may be why we don't have the 20 minutes of public comment today, although obviously it's good for us to have room for that. Okay. Hearing no one else in the public comment period at this time, before we go into our involvement in conversations with organizations such as Bridge for Unity and the Town Council, I just want to quickly note again that the Amherst Regional Public Schools organized some discussions that were affinity group discussions. So that went with Petua's idea from our last meeting that there be discussions that are more in-group discussions and supportive in the first instance that might allow people to express concerns and perspectives without having their identity perhaps challenged or their experiences nullified in some way or erased in some way by having a large group discussion where they are not viewed as being central to how that discussion should move forward. I also want to say thank you to our town in general and the Educators for Black Lives Matters rally, and Petua spoke beautifully at that rally. Thank you, Petua. And so I think that there was some good movement through our education system. And I want us to think about that as being one of the models that we would use as far as either discussion groups that are planned in advance or breakout sessions that would allow for smaller group discussion. And that's part of what we discussed in our last meeting. Gazit Chaya.
Petua, did you have your hand raised? Okay, sorry, just thought you did.
Okay. So that's one model that I think we can think about, and we can come back to that when we're looking at how we would frame discussion groups. Discussion around the police department, we can have that now, or we can have that after we've discussed engagement of organizations like Bridge for Unity and the involvement of the town council. If everyone is going to wants to stay on for the remainder of our meeting, then it might help to get the report on the police department first, so that we have a framework for what some discussions look like and whether we might need to find ways to make it clearer to the public that we're having those conversations in order to make sure that we're getting as much feedback or getting as much representation as possible. So on that front, I would turn it over to Gazit Chaya at this point to discuss that.
Thanks, Matthew. So I'll just briefly share that we did have myself, Dr. Milkar Shabazz and Dr. Demetrius Shabazz met with the police chief, Captain Ting, who's one of the officers, Paul Bachelman, Shalini, and Pat, who are both town counselors, to ask some very specific questions around current policies and procedures and budgeting, just to get a baseline understanding of where Amherst currently is. And I think the conversation was brief, but I think it showed us some areas where we certainly can now as a community look at how the police may be taking on responsibilities that other social services might be better suited to take on, and how to look at that as a community, and specifically in terms of our budget. There were 59 community members who attended, and there was not an opportunity for the community members to engage in a meaningful way, and something that just personally I feel really strongly about is that that indicates a really strong need on the part of the community to have conversation around these issues. And I appreciate Lindsay, who came to just reiterate that. And I have encouraged the town councilors and Paul and Chief Livingstone to think about how they can open themselves up to the community to listen, whether that be a town hall or that be partnering with us on some specific dialogue opportunities. But there's definitely a need to talk and for people to understand what we as a community are experiencing right now and where we might want to move. So I think there's a lot of room to move forward. It was certainly just an introductory information gathering starting point. And one of the points that I really heard the chief and Captain Ting acknowledge is that they have struggled to receive feedback from the community. And we talked about how there are real reasons that barriers to participation and barriers for folks on giving that feedback, and that they are open to understanding what those barriers are and to working to take some of those down so that they can be in better communication. So I think it's really a time for us as the Human Rights Commission and for us as community members to think about how to take them up on that and to figure out ways that we can organize and work together to communicate what we want to see in our town.
Thank you. I attended as a community member, and so I got to be an attendee, and I know I attempted to use the Q&A function, and so I put questions in, and the host, I guess, was unable to see the questions, and so we ended up, so that felt like there was an additional level of disconnect that perhaps we might have been able to avoid in some way. But,
can I just speak specifically to that? So unfortunately, the sort of the original intent of the meeting was not for it to be a community discussion. Right. And we had sent a specific set of questions to the chief to respond to. And so while all those wonderful questions were coming through, we only had that 1 hour, and he had agreed to go through that set of questions that we had given him. And after the fact, because I had originally had a meeting with the chief of police last year, which I think I told you all about, with my town counselor, Shalini, she then shared with other town counselors who then shared with other people. And before we knew it, a bunch of people were invited, which we were happy to have people join, but it wasn't set up as a community discussion. So unfortunately, I think the unintentional byproduct of that was that people felt like we weren't listening to them, or like we weren't acknowledging them. And that was a real shame, because that was not the intention at all. And that is why I keep reiterating, the community has a lot to say and a lot to ask. And I really feel that it's the town and the police department and the town council's responsibility to acknowledge that need and to give people opportunities to come and to really give them the time that your question deserved and that so many other questions deserved, because it wasn't set up for that meeting to be able to address those. And so I'm really sorry for that.
Okay. I brought that up just because I think that there was, and now I see that there's a Q&A here, right? A comment about a face-to-face facilitated conversation. And while that, one of the struggles that I think we're all having is how to have that kind of facilitated conversation when we aren't face-to-face, when we do have these technological difficulties, and where we are trying to make sure people feel heard and respected. And there's certainly not an intention to make people feel cut off or feel disconnected. And you know, I think when Gazi, when you said that you were going to be having this meeting as a citizen, you know, I thought I'd be happy to attend, and I wasn't planning on asking questions in any event, but I couldn't help myself once I was there to type something in. But I think trying to come up with a way for, I think it was great for people to hear the questions that were prepared in advance and to hear the answers to those questions. It's just, it was certainly a struggle for me to hear Chief Livingstone say that, you know, we ask every year for comments on how we could do better and we never get them. And so the only question I put in was, how do we publicize that? Is there a way for us to share that? And is there a way for the comments once they go in, are they something that everyone has a chance to review? And so that was the only question I posed, because I thought, you know, if our chief of police is saying, I really wish I could hear more voices. But, you know, I did put in that whenever a committee chair every year is asked, how is your town manager doing? And we get an email and we have a chance to respond and say, Paul is doing great. And so that's wonderful. But if I don't see the same kind of email or outreach about the police department, and, you know, as chair of the Human Rights Commission, I don't see that many people would be seeing that and would be getting that. And so I think it would be great for us to, once we have that information, to share that broadly so that people can speak to the police department and not just either make a complaint that we hear about or make a complaint by meeting with the superintendent.
There's another question in the Q&A.
In the Q&A.
Says, can town manager Paul Bockelman speak to the idea of having a town hall?
Paul, would you like to speak to the idea of having that kind of town hall conversation with the police chief?
Absolutely, yeah. I think that we're very interested in doing that. I know that you have three counselors who are in the audience who have been talking about this and eager to do this as well. We've talked, you know, I think you're right, Matthew, how difficult it is in a virtual setting to have something as, I don't know how you do a face-to-face facilitated conversation, which I think is what's needed in a virtual setting, but we can figure out how to make that happen. But I think it is really important for the town to be in a listening mode. And, you know, we've been looking at ways to do that better for the police department. So yes, definitely want to do that. And the chief and Captain Ting are both eager to do that as well. So, and it's just a matter of what's the best way to do that. And then I leave it to the HRC and the counselors are the ones to do it. We'll be anywhere, whenever is best. But I do know that, you know, the council president has talked a lot about trying to figure out where this goes on to the council. You know, not a regular meeting, maybe at a regular meeting, however they want to do it, and do it at a time that's not at night, maybe on a Saturday afternoon or a Sunday afternoon, stuff, so other people can participate and do multiple times, at least for this first phase, I think, is what they're thinking.
And if we wanted to, thank you, Paul, if we wanted to invite the town councilors in at this point, Shabazz has just put in the Q&A, communication from Shalini about some tentative dates they have set aside for conversation. So,
yeah, and and Lynn Griesmer, who is also on the call, also an attendee right now, spoke with me about the possibility of us co-hosting with the town council and you know, working to try to think about what a facilitated discussion would look like. We discussed the possibility of bringing in someone who perhaps isn't in our community. One of the concerns I had about a community member facilitating a conversation is that that community member's voice is going to have to shift, right? So if one of us, for example, tried to act as a facilitator, A, people know us from being members of the community and may have expectations of what our views might be, which might make facilitation less credible. And B, if we were acting in a role as a facilitator, and I can say this as someone who doesn't necessarily take pleasure at running meetings, but because I'd much rather just chime in every once in a while with what I think is a really great idea. But if you're facilitating, you can't really do that in the same way. So it makes it a little bit trickier. So I think we're looking at trying to see and if we can come up with some names to present to the town council as potential facilitators. So if any of you have, particularly people who in this time period where distrust nationwide is in part stemming from the history of racial violence of our country and of our police forces, not specifically the Amherst Police Department, but police departments generally, and frankly, policing because of that nationwide history, frankly, global history. People of color, particularly African-Americans and Latinx people, have experience of fear. And so a facilitator who doesn't minimize that would be incredibly helpful. So as you think of people to recommend, please consider that as well.
And I think that's part of why we've invited Bridge for Unity, correct? Is that they've been doing this work and have offered to work with us on this project. And we have two representatives, Deborah and I believe the name was Pat, but now it's not here anymore, who have come tonight to talk about that.
Paul?
So thanks. So I have to jump off and I totally apologize. I'll watch the rest of this meeting. But I do want to recognize, I mean, I think what was put in the chat could be read out. But again, just to note that we have three counselors who are looking for help in how to frame it. And so I'm glad you guys are thinking along these same lines. So I apologize. I have to go, though. So.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Paul. And I don't know whether it is Dr. D. Shabazz or Dr. Amilcar Shabazz, who is pointing out that Bridge for Unity has non-Amherst residents who can help and has, again, cited some of the language of looking at trying to organize the discussion. So for those of you who can look at the Q&A, we'll see first a description of intergroup dialogue as discussed, and then the question of, or the manner in which we can move forward. So before moving on, though, I wanted to ask of the commissioners first if there were any further questions about the meeting that Gazit Haya and Doctors Dean Amilcar Shabazz organized with our police chief and with Captain Ting.
I just want to make a suggestion, if possible, that as we go forth with some of these meetings, there may be some communities that may not feel either safe or don't want to engage in these conversations in front of police officers. that we figure out a way to still get those voices in. So I'll use myself as an example, as somebody who's of Cape Verdean descent, who has great relationships with the Cape Verdean community. And I know that we do have some folks here that may not be documented. I can't see them going into these discussions. You know, I could lead a conversation with folks from the Cape Verdean community and try to get some of those views, and then those who are willing to come to this setting to bring come with them and have that discussion. And those that were not, then if they would give me their permission, I could bring some of their views in. It's what I'm saying. So that way, that discussion will still take place, but not necessarily in front of whatever, you know, way we set it up, because people may not feel comfortable when they're, and it could be a plethora of reasons. Language is also part of it. You know, some people, I know in the Cape Verdean community don't speak English fluently or don't speak it at all. So I just wanted to throw in that suggestion.
Thank you. I think Azikaya also raised a similar point. And with the police chief and Captain Ting, and Captain Ting said at that point how thankful he was to hear that point, because as far as hearing other voices, when the police department looks at it through one lens and they think, well, this is the answer, we just have to make ourselves available and people will come in, they didn't even think about the fact that there were people who would feel uncomfortable coming in. So that was definitely part of the conversation. But thank you for bringing it up here, because I wouldn't have repeated it otherwise.
Yeah. Go ahead, Elizabeth.
I just wanted to add another thing, which is, you know, having done community outreach in law enforcement for some time myself, I think that part of what's important is also making it very clear that there's kind of a long-term commitment to this, that it isn't just like, oh, we have a problem this year, let's have 3 or 4 meetings and then we'll kind of stop doing it. I mean, that's inevitably kind of the thing that happens, but in my observation and experience, you have to like keep going past the point when it's a big issue in order to get to a deeper level of trust. So I would support that. And, you know, as much as I can continue to be involved on this issue, I will try to do that.
Thank you. Well, Guzzi, hi, I was waiting to say something too, I believe.
That's okay. I see Ben has a hand up. So go ahead, Ben.
Yeah, I just had like a clarifying question, because there's something like a red flag that kind of went up there. So with the answer about feedback from the community, did the chief mean solicited feedback from the community, or was there like the I don't know, the feeling that just they don't hear anything from the community? Because that kind of just blows my mind personally, because I've written them copious letters.
Yeah, I that was something that I felt strongly about too, Ben, because I have tons of friends who have specifically communicated how they've been treated here, and to town councilors and to school officials. So I think that's an important point. And I think that that's something for our community to really acknowledge, that like who is being listened to and who's being seen as giving feedback. Like, when is feedback actually considered feedback and when is it not? And how that is racialized in a lot of instances.
Sid?
It part of it is also, you know, process, right? So a lot of times, and I'm talking from my experience at UMass, we hear all of these, you know, feedback, right, about the police. And sometimes we all know that the way process is set up, sometimes it does not allow those voices to get in. So at UMass, for example, this happened some time ago where, you know, I was bringing some of these concerns to the police chief, not the current police chief. And he was like, Sid, if the students and faculty and staff don't put a formal complaint in, written complaint in, then nothing exists, right? So again, processes sometimes are used to exclude people. So maybe that's what we may want to do, is talk to the police chief or whatever, maybe we need to change the process, right? Maybe a verbal, just a verbal communication, that is something that would be official, that is on record. You're more of a lawyer than I am, but you know, but sometimes that's how it was. You know, if it was not a written complaint, you know, then it didn't exist. And according to disciplinary actions through the UMass system, you would have been like, nope, nothing exists in this person's files, so therefore there's nothing we can do to discipline. So it's processes, right? So so that's something that we also may need to take a look at.
I just want to make two quick points on that. The first was that I do believe he was talking about a specific, Chief Livingstone was talking about a specific annual request to the town, how are we doing? Please give specific feedback, as opposed to hearing comments from people throughout the year. That said, I don't think that the two are mutually exclusive. And I think if you're getting comments from people throughout the year, if you're getting letters in, that's something that you should be able to work from. That said, I also would point out that we have, when we get people who come to our meetings and who speak, and then they realize, oh, I don't want to make a complaint, or they go to the human rights director and say, you know, I want to make a complaint. And then when they discuss the fact that that becomes public and that you know, other people would have access to information regarding the complaint, they then say, actually, there might be a different way for me to handle it. And so when I hear about those things, I report generally what I've heard to the commission, but without giving specifics, because we're trying to not identify the individual who's asked not to be identified. I don't know if when people go in and meet with Chief Livingstone, and we've talked about this before, the fact that while he has a fairly open door policy that people can come in and talk with him if they have a complaint, they have to walk through the police station. They may have to see the officer about whom they're making a complaint, and that is unnerving, disconcerting, and it should be. And so we have to come up with better ways for the police department to be able to hear concerns that we have. Deborah, and then Gazitai.
I was just going to say that if the police are actually hearing and receiving feedback throughout the year, then they would have a better sense of how they're doing. That's at the risk of stating the obvious. But also, I think that is the benefit of these in-person listening sessions or forums or whatever it is that we want to describe them. There are minutes, there people are there witnessing. So, it, you know, the feedback that is given is sort of unavoidable. And I think that if like folks like Sid or others, any of us who are connected to people who really are not going to feel comfortable stepping forward and voicing anything at these meetings or even possibly attending, that we could work with them on the side to help formulate a letter. And, you know, it's an anonymous letter and one of us reads it. And so there, you know, so that there definitely are ways that we could support people who just simply don't feel comfortable.
Although I just point out recording, if we are having sessions that are recorded, it is very hard to express any vulnerabilities.
Yeah.
When you know you're being recorded, and so that's something we have to give some thought to.
The only other thing I do want to say is I want to echo what Elizabeth said, that I have also witnessed that when you host continuous listening sessions over the course of a year, by the third or the fourth one, people are voicing a lot more. So the first one is usually very quiet. People are very, you know, maybe fearful and shy, and they build over time. So I agree with that comment and feel like whatever we do, we should post this as a series, you know.
I agree with that as well. Gazitai.
I was just gonna say, out of respect for the people who have come to speak to the agenda items that we have left, I would like to encourage us to transition to the community sessions and hear from Deborah Snow from Bridge for Unity and the town councilors.
I was just about to say the same thing. Okay, so I am would be happy to have an understanding of how organized engagement or engagement of other organizations might be able to help us. So for Bridge for Unity, would you put your hand up so I can allow you to speak? So that's under, yeah, if you under can the make... participants. Do you have access to that to click raise hand?
So it's Deborah with the D, yeah. Okay. And then Dr. Milkar Shabazz is here as well from Bridge for Unity.
Okay. So Deborah, please.
Hi there. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great, great. First, thank you for having this commission and also for inviting us. I'm happy to talk about Bridge for Unity. A little history is so that you get us somewhat of an understanding who we are. In 2017, my partner Barbara and I, we owned the Blue Heron restaurant. We took a vacation to South Carolina where we met a woman from the Low Country, a Gullah artist named Sonia Griffin Evans. We had an incredible connection and invited her to be part of the Blue Heron's 20th anniversary. She came up with some performers and she's an incredible storyteller, and she showed her art, told stories, and the performers sang and played the piano. And we had about 100 people there, and one of the things I really noticed was an incredible desire to talk, to learn, and to find the true history of this country we live in. And it was from that coupled with the rage and sadness and hopelessness that I often felt with the killings of Black people in the US and dealing with the America's original sin and colonization, that I needed to do something. But it wasn't my place to decide what that is without conversation. And so it was then a journey to begin that conversation and to seek out people who would be part of it. And I would say that's how Bridge for Unity started. We have been doing this for almost 2 years. There's about a little over 20 of us from this area, the Connecticut River Valley, from Southwick to probably Montague, where Barbara and I live. We've been having these dialogues. They include, you know, and it's not official dialogues, but I would say from time to time, it's difficult conversations. It includes having dinner together until we had to meet like this. So we're breaking bread together. There's some socialization, you know, just socializing, and then we go into a conversation period. We also traveled together to Beaufort, South Carolina, where we met with the South Carolinians, and also some people from Kentucky who came, who are part of Hands Across the Hills. And then that was a year ago in January, and then a year ago in June, we all met here for a 3-day retreat. And we've continued the conversations with the folks in the other two states, but we've also continued here. Something that Elizabeth said is a really important part of our this group, Bridge for Unity, is commitment. It isn't something that can happen once or twice. Trust has to be formed. So many people have walked down this line before. Let's have conversation, let's have dialogue. but we don't get anywhere. I feel that our group has gotten to a pretty powerful space. And again, here we are, filled with rage, saying people's names, functioning, trying to function, and each of us having our different amounts of rage for different reasons. Knowing that as I look at this group, knowing that all the people of color are in much greater danger of living and being harassed than I am as a white woman. But I think as a group, we have begun to deal with that. We have begun to solve the problems in our group, in our little community of 20 people, to build allyship. And that's where I find the strength. I think of each of these people every day. They mentor me, they school me, and hopefully, you know, I do the same. And I think we all need to do this. I certainly think the town, people in the town of Amherst, I've certainly very connected with the town of Amherst just because so many of our guests in our restaurant are from Amherst. It's powerful. I think it's powerful, but the piece that's powerful is the commitment. You know, there's not a person in this group I wouldn't help. I wouldn't be there. I would be there for. I would fight for each person in this group every day. And I don't know if I would have said that 2 years ago, but I say that now. And I think for most of us, it's been life-changing. Please, anyone, questions? Amilcar D, I think, are on. They're part of the group.
Thanks so much, Deborah.
Yep, thank you. I want to ask, Dr. Shabazz, one of the doctors, Shabazz, is ready to speak, and maybe they can answer as well. But, you know, whether this is scalable. So if we're talking about reaching a larger number of people throughout the town of Amherst, giving people a chance to talk with each other, you know, whether the model of saying, you know, we are going to be in community with a relatively small group of people who may have very different views can scale up to hundreds and perhaps thousands of people who may want to engage in that conversation.
I'd love to hear what the others think about that, but you know, I think 20 people is a lot, but we had I think about 30 in our groups in I think when we were in Amherst last June, and there are ways that you break those groups down. I think that you need a level of intimacy. I would see that it's scalable and that you would have more than one small group of say 20, 15, 20 people. But that, you know, I'm in an organization, a business organization, and the interesting thing, and it drives me a little crazy too, is that we all watched George Floyd die, get killed, get murdered. And now we want to fix it right away. And I have this business group, you know, how can we fix it? And what I want to say to everyone is you need to put it in your calendar every day that you give a certain amount of time to your racism. You learn and you unlearn and you learn and you unlearn and you see what your organization can do or your business can do, but you reach out. And so that's the kind of commitment that I think a group, if you meet once, twice, no, you can't get anywhere. So in doing it in Amherst, I would think you would need a number of groups that would commit to at least a year, every month.
Well, I also want to hear from the doctors, Shabazz, but I would point out that for many of us, raising our kids, we have to have those conversations every day, and we have them every day. And we say, we're living constricted lives of what we can wear, where we can go, how we can carry ourselves when we walk down the street. And we're having those conversations because it's a question of survival.
Right.
I think it's important for people who are willing to have the conversation to understand that we're not coming at it from a blank slate. Mm-mm. We're coming at it from conversations that had to be had with us when we were kids. I think about my father talking about when he was driving on the highway, having to pack his lunch because there was nowhere for him to stop because Black people were not allowed to go. When he was growing up, he was born in 32. When he was growing up, he was not able to stop because those public accommodations were not available. Those conversations are, it's good to have everyone wanting to come in and come together. But for a lot of us, we already know that we're not starting with George Floyd. We'll say his name, but there are thousands of names we can say.
I'm not sure a lot of white people know that, though.
Yeah, which is part of the issue of trying to have a conversation, though, where other people come in thinking, I understand this. I saw this, and I now believe that this is a problem. Perhaps you've been saying this all your life, but I've now seen it. Now I believe it. There's something kind of erasing of the experience of having spoken for years about it and asked other people to care about it for years. I'm happy that people are responding now. But again, for a lot of us, we've seen this moment before. Sure. We've been in this moment before. People are not remembering today Gavin Cato, the 7-year-old who was killed in Crown Heights in 1991 when it was hit by a car, and an ambulance came and picked up the driver of the car who had bumped his head and left that 7-year-old boy to die. There are, again, thousands of these stories that some of us are coming to the table with all of that background. And so, trying to figure out what it means to have the conversation where even talking about it kind of raises my blood pressure a little bit. And mm-hmm. So I wonder about those people who don't, aren't aware or haven't been made aware of it and do want to see change. And so I welcome them to want to make that change. But I also am trying to deal with not adding additional stressors to myself and to my loved ones as we engage in this conversation.
Dr. Shabazz, hopefully you'll chime in here too.
Am I unmuted?
Yes, you are.
Okay, so the scale question goes back to the previous meeting that I was in on, and when I heard the question come up about whether the Human Rights Commission might be an appropriate body to try to help lead or facilitate a virtual town hall discussion of these issues, because as Gazit said earlier, we were clear that our meeting was not a virtual town hall. We were very clear that that is not what was motivating us to set up the meeting with the chief. It was more of an informational kind of fact gathering, getting a baseline understanding of what our department is before you could talk about defunding or disbanding or anything. You have to have some understanding of what what you do have in place that's providing your public safety, or is supposed to be providing your public safety. So we wanted to have that discussion, that conversation, in an unmediated, in a unhostile, non-contentious way. But then along the way, there was this great interest and more people wanting to be in as panelists and participants and so on, that's where, when we were in the storm of that and hearing that emerge, and we had this meeting on of the Human Rights Commission, and I was there to talk about civil war plaques, actually, that's where, when I heard the conversation going toward, well, what might the commission do as a body concerned with human rights in Amherst, and toward this question of the sense of desire that's out there for the community to want to be in dialogue with the town officials and with the police about our police department, and in light of what is happening, what's going on, and so I heard from you all some concerns about, you know, your own sort of skill set or ability to act as a facilitator for such conversations as might be really needed right now in Amherst. And that's where B for You came to my mind, because in addition to everything that Deborah has said, what we've done over the 2 years, besides have these deeply meaningful, engaging conversations, dialogues, and building up a certain kind of trust and allyship and solidarity between us, we've also been learning and developing and studying the different methods and aspects of the process itself of intergroup dialogue. You know, my wife taught it and has done research on it at UMass, Ximena Zuniga, Leda Cooks, a colleague of ours in public health. They actually, I was in the chancellor's office, then gave them support to have an international intergroup dialogue conference here a few years ago. So all I was jumping off of is that we have abundant expertise that could come in and work with some of you all on the commission, if there is the interest and the will to do so, that you could, for yourself, not have to hire out, not have to go and get some facilitator out of Boston or Springfield or wherever to come here, but that you yourselves could learn some of the basic techniques to help to facilitate what I was hearing as this big desire for a virtual town hall. All right, so that's the background of it. But to the question of scale, I think we really have to ask what is the interest, and what would you as a commission really be most committed to wanting to facilitate, wanting to help step to this perceived need right now in Amherst for community discussion with and about policing, and what really is the scale of interest for that? What I'm saying is not that you then have to go out to every apartment complex and every home and beat the bushes and beg people to come out, but I mean, it's already there. The people are already there, and if you just set it up, they're going to be there. What is that number? Is it 20? Is it 30? Is it 50? Is it thousands? I think you have to go into it thinking about that, and what is the real interest level? What is the, and maybe you'd be right with the guess you'd make or the approximation you'd make, and then you start putting it out, you set up something and you put out the RSVP, and then, hey, if you thought it's 50, and then all of a sudden you've got 500 RSVP, well, okay, your estimation your estimates were off. And then you still have to see who actually comes, because 500 can check off, they'll be there, and then oftentimes that's not the case for myriad reasons. So I think it's a question of thinking about what is the scale of interest that is here. Not that HRC has to go and drum up, not that Amherst Media has to go and drum up, not that any one of us on this call has to go and drum up, but what is the scale of interest in having a meaningful conversation, meaningful dialogue about policing and about our police department with our town officials and with the police? And then from that estimate of the scale, you then begin to design the type of meeting that will get you at, that you hope will best afford a meaningful opportunity for an hour and a half, for 2 hours, whatever, for that interest to find those officials and have the meaningful conversation. And that can be conversation one in a series, that could be one and done, who knows? I mean, that's also part of, that's another question you'll have to ask. Are you committing to this as a series? Are you committing to this as one and done? And let somebody else take it from there, what have you. So those are some of the kinds of questions beyond just, is the methodology scalable? Because yes, the methodology is scalable. Even now within this telemeeting environment, where those of us in doing intergroup dialogue are confronting the issues of scalability through this electronic format, let alone to whenever we might be able to get back to face-to-face, or if we can get, if the governor and the officials allow us to do face-to-face, as long as it's 6 feet apart and outdoors or what have you. I mean, these are all technical questions we have to look at. But I think prior to all of that is really to ask and to try to assess what is the genuine interest level, what is the scale of that interest level, and then what are the best methods to facilitate that. Our old town meeting idea, where we can get a couple of hundred people together in the middle school auditorium, that's out. We can't operate our mind from that context, at least right now. That's not safe. That's not publicly allowed. And so we're not, so you got to throw that out of your head. But what is available to us now that we could do outdoors, 6 feet apart, or that we can do by telemeeting? And then how best do you, how do you want to approach the question of scale? Do you want to, you know, have people check in, and RSVP, and then, you know, once you get to a certain number, you maybe close that session out and say, okay, for those others that are interested, we'll look at setting up an additional time, or we'll have to set up a different way of addressing those past that first 30 that check in, that first 50 that check in. I think I've said enough, but the first thing is to assess what is the interest, to assess whether you as a commission want to be part of helping to facilitate that interest level that is there, and then figure out what are the methods relative to the scale of that interest level that you want to then address. Because again, if it's in the telemeeting format or a hybrid of telemeeting and some people physically on an outdoor site 6 feet apart, you know, there is, you can then set what your number would be, put the word out, and then take the first 30, take the first 50, and then set up the breakout session, set up the format, talk with the town officials and talk with the police department about how the those from the police department who are going to participate about how you're going to structure. There might be different breakout sessions on different topics that then Captain Ting will be in the topic about use of force with seven people. Or, and the chief is gonna be over here with a small group addressing the question of setting up a permanent citizen review board, civilian review board, or citizen oversight committee, thinking of strategically about what would that look like? How would we do that? And having a certain number of people in that session. Another session may address mental health issues. And you'd have the person out of the force who's pinpointed on mental health issues coming in and then talk, and then able the people in that one be talking about how do we get more mental health care providers structured in this work rather than it being relatively untrained police officers going out to handle people with mental health issues that calls are coming in on. So do you begin to follow, you address what do you want to respond to this need? Do you then assess what is the scale of it? And then you begin to design the way you want to do this according to the methods and according to the goals and the outcome that you want to have with your town officials, with your police department, and with the citizens, the people of the community, with this interest that you invite to come into the discussion.
Well, thank you. I think that's helpful to see that others are thinking through the concerns. I don't know if that puts us in a position where we're suggesting that it really needs to be bottom-up driven or grassroots driven. Who really wants to talk with our governmental leaders, our town leaders, with the police officers, and on what issues, what expertise those individuals within the police department, for example, would need to have to be prepared for those conversations, or whether it's something where we say these are issues that as the Human Rights Commission, we think we should educate our town on. We think this is an important issue, and we're going to ask the police department to be prepared to open up and have a conversation. And we're willing to have a group of people come in to listen, and then those who are interested go into breakout groups on Zoom so that they can engage in a conversation. And one of the things we talked about in our last meeting, Petua brought up the idea of having people who might want to first talk amongst a group of people who may have had similar experiences before expanding beyond that. And so I think that's something that isn't off the table yet either. So Bridge for Unity, I think, has as a premise that there's going to be intergroup dialogue, and that intergroup dialogue, and please forgive me if I'm misrepresenting in any way the work that Bridge for Unity is doing, but that intergroup dialogue is going to be enriched because of that variation in perspective. And I'm not sure that we're quite there yet on that being the route that we would suggest. But again, we're trying to come up with something sooner rather than later so that conversations can begin.
But don't you think that, I'm sorry, because I can't raise my hand. But so okay. Don't you think that even if we just start off with a small group, that small group will get bigger eventually? Like if we just start off something small. And that is, even if we start off first with having these small groups where people feel more comfortable to be able to present it to the next group of people and then perhaps present it to the next group of people. I mean, kind of got to start somewhere, right?
But that still doesn't answer whether it's us saying or the police department saying, here's an issue I know a lot of people are talking about. We're ready to present. And therefore, we're going to have a webinar discussion, which would be top down and would perhaps that's not what people want to talk about, but it might draw a certain number of people and it could be a small group and maybe that'll grow. But it might also stifle conversation from those who are really interested in talking about something else right now. And both approaches have reasons to them and are both of them are fine in different circumstances. But we have to make a determination of which methodology we want to support.
Pardon me, Matthew.
Please.
And I one thing to note, our group, while there was variation, it was very much curated. And while we were people from many different backgrounds and walks of life, it wasn't random. So there was definitely a level of curating who came into that 20-30 people. But I'd love it if Petua might revisit kind of her thoughts about this within this group. In terms of the experience of what you're seeing, I love to hear you speak on things. But if you could just revisit what you were addressing,
I think I've just been listening to all of the conversation, which has been great. I think personally, I believe that it's important that it starts like grassroots from bottom up because. Like we've seen the way that top bottom like governing and ways of facilitating conversations causes harm and silences people. And we've like, everyone's been talking about that. Like Sid was talking about that with the Cape Verdean community in relation to the police. Like there's not the comfort between those two groups are not there. So having like the police host a discussion about policing and how they're going to change may not bring the appropriate people to help create that change, and instead making it more of we did something, so now you can't come at us for anything because we actually did something. So I think that I personally think that it's important that it's grassroots from bottom up, and I also I appreciate the Bridge for Unity Unity's mission of like relationship building, which I think is really important, and I think that's lacking in a lot of like governments. Even in the Human Rights Commission, we don't really have established like presence in the community, but it's very limited to certain groups of people. And I think that working on that relationship was really important to create the change that we want to see. But then I think that by seeing the images and videos of Black people, men and women and trans and all those Black people that have been killed by the police, there's like a shared experience that we all have, whether we are just experiencing it for the first time or not. And we must, I think I appreciate what Matthew was saying about how like many people have already had their parents talk about this with them or experiencing it themselves. And so like, we must make sure that their voices are like, I don't want to say elevated, but like make sure that people know that this isn't just a one-time issue. And then I appreciate what Bridge for Unity was saying about like how people wanted to learn about the history of the America and how that influences where we are today. So when thinking about how to like specifically have these discussions, I think that it's important that there's a goal in mind and that it's that the like structure of what we do is centering around people who have experience and stories to tell and not people who have power or authority to exert onto people. Cause I think that causes some structure problems that like prevent people, the most important people that need to be heard to be silenced in many ways. And we see that with what Sid was saying earlier about how like the police don't hear these stories if it's not formal. I think we should create it in a way that it's intentional, that the process is making sure that all people are heard and are able to come to these discussions and feel like they matter in the discussion that we're having. And I think one way in doing that is establishing what the goal is and then making the structure of these conversations match like what our vision is for these conversations that we're gonna have. So yeah.
Petra, were the discussions run through the high school structured in that way, or were they more free flowing?
I think that the when I went to two discussions, I went to the young women of color discussion and a Alana group, which is like basically a people of color group. And in both the women of color group, I was the only student that went. There were two teachers that were facilitating, it was just me. But we had a really great conversation about like what it means, the intersections of like being a woman and a person of color, and how we can use our power with both of those to move forward. And what we did in that conversation was set norms. But the fact, like, I was the only student that was there. So like, there's not much that we can do at that time. And it's, with the other conversation, there was like five or six students and then two adults as well. I think that having those things come through like from above, because it was from the school that offered these things, which is top down in my opinion, but it's still the discussions, the people that show up can help create more discussions. And you know that the people that are showing up to those discussions are ready to have those discussions and move forward. And from there, we can build leadership from those people that do show up. But I think that the way the connect, like, I think for like the school in general, the school hasn't created a relationship with their students so that they can just send an email about we're having discussions because someone was killed and we want to talk about it and make sure you guys don't feel like you're left behind. You can't just do that when someone's killed. You have to have that relationship before. And I think that's where the school has failed deeply, but they're trying to make up for it, but it's still, it like that harm has already been done. And so then the commitment and connection between the two factors, or the two people, the authority and adults versus the students, it's making like a tension that doesn't need to be there, but it's created be based off of the structure and the communication between the two groups. So I think the discussions we did have with the people who did show up were great. But the goal is not really, I don't think the goal was really there. It was just to talk. And I think talking is great. It's great to have those discussions to build connections, and maybe they will spark inspiration. I know it does for me all the time, but for most people, especially like knowing that we grow up in systems and abide to systems that don't help us like make sure that those systems include everyone, where it's like a capitalistic society that we live in. But I don't want to get into that. But I think that knowing that we are already engaging in harmful systems and structures, we have to acknowledge that. And I think that's what Matthew was trying to say. And move forward knowing that we have a history of harm, and we need to address that harm in a way that centers around those who experience the harm, are not as victims, which I think is one of the ways top-down leadership like ends up being. We're trying to victimize the people, and we want to hear your voices, but only as a victim. I feel like that we should go to people and have spaces for people to come to us that want to come as witnesses and like people who have experienced something and move forward. And I think it will start small, like Jennifer was saying, but it's some place to start. I think that's a great place to start. So, yeah.
Both Deborah and Amilcar have their hands up, so I want to give both of them a chance to speak.
I have a question. And so one is, or two questions, I guess, or the general question is the direction. So we're here talking about the police and wanting to figure out how to go forward on that. And we're also talking about community. And there's a place where they meet. And I don't know, in my view, I think both have to be dealt with together and separately. They're not mutually exclusive, but one of the things I have found in Bridge for Unity, that as we meet, we can then plan action. We had to build some trust to get there. But I also see that there are some efforts that need to be done rather quickly to make the community feel safer with the police and furthering discussion there. So I'm just feeling like there's two needs here. Is that everyone's take?
I think that that's certainly a valid point that, you know, there are, and therefore there may need to be multiple approaches over time. But the question of how to frame that and how to start the process is something I hope we can move in that direction tonight.
And just one other question is, isn't it possible to move both grassroots and top down? Aren't there ways to do that? I mean, I would hope the town council people would, number one, want to do this, recognize a need, and ask for that to happen. I would certainly hope the police chief and other police officers would want to move forward so this community is better and stronger. And I know that there are many people within the community who want these discussions, whether that's members of maybe leaders, just everybody, plus leaders in religious organizations or business. You know, I come from a business and my work is very much on getting businesses to give, to function properly, well, what I think is properly, to work for social justice. I think that to solve or to work on action with the police, that everyone has to be involved, different members, and that there could be some reach out from members of you all, to get other people then to reach out to their folks who would then join in so that it could be both.
Okay, and Dr. Amilcar Shabazz had his hand up. It's down now. I'm not sure if, and then after that, Shalini Bal, who is one of our town councilors, is ready to speak.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear from the councilors. My concern that I'm triggered is when we talk about bottom up and then we talk about top down or whatever other kinds of approaches, you know, what I'm really concerned about is people want to see action. The councilors are wanting to do things for their constituency, but then there's the question of legitimacy and what is legitimate change and whether or not people are going to accept certain things that are done as legitimate or not, because, you know, they were moving from the bottom up and nobody listened. And, you know, other people did things from the top down. And so now you're picking people, you know, for a citizen oversight or civilian review board. And, you know, the town manager gets to pick these people. And, you know, is it the usual suspects, or is someone in there who does have a linkage to the Cape Verdean community? Is someone in there who does have a linkage to, you know, some of the other immigrant, high immigrant population areas? Someone in there with a real link to the mentally, you know, the folks with mental health issues, and is able to, and not because it's their job or, you know, they have some kind of, you know, paying gig dealing with it, but, you know, for some, but have a real connection. So, yeah, Shalini, how do you see this?
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So, if I may, I would just like to start by saying I am sorry. I just want to say it took me all this time and seeing, I did it took me thousands and thousands of people suffering, dying to wake me up. I'm sorry for that. And I just want to say as an individual and who is in town council that I am committed to continue with the work and not let this die down. That being said, I was also wondering if there is a third kind of gathering we could have for healing. And I don't come from a background of social justice. I don't necessarily understand. And I'm asking for forgiveness ahead of time. I'm going to make many mistakes along the way, but I'm willing to show up. I'm willing to listen and learn. And I'm wondering if there are other people in the community who feel a similar need to show up, and maybe we need a third kind of gathering that's for healing, of bringing us together in silent prayer, chanting, saying sorry. I don't know. So I just want to say that. That's one thing. The other thing I'm hearing is that there is a need to fix things, you know, when we get uncomfortable and you want to fix. And I heard Deborah say that, and I think we need to be able to have the patience to sit with the uncertainty and not jump and take things, you know, slowly as they're happening. And the other thing I'm hearing is that we could have these two different types of gatherings. One is the affinity group meetings that are happening at the grassroots levels, and then also having the town hall where we have the breakouts, like Amilcar suggested, where they could be sharing that information and breakout rooms and so forth. To continue with the long-term commitment, I feel there needs to be a steering committee with some of the town leaders involved and community members and residents. I really do feel that we have an opportunity right now with very committed, caring leadership, whether it's coming from Paul, whether it's the town council, it's the business, some of the business leaders that Deborah, including Deborah. And so how do we engage all the stakeholders right now who are willing and able? So maybe some kind of a steering committee would be helpful. And I just want to thank Petua. I'm sorry, I don't know how to pronounce your name. Petua, is that right? Kind of right? Can you put
Petua, something? Yeah.
Petua,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think everything you've said today and at the gathering, I believe it was you. I couldn't make out who it was, but I was so moved when I heard you. I was crying. I was like, wow, you've given me, like, it's really made me think how many times I didn't speak up, or because I felt I didn't sound smart enough, and I saw all of you just speaking, whether people were fumbling or awkward, but you just spoke up. And that really gives me the courage to speak up. That's all I have for now. I just want to say that the town council is here with all of you, and we will support you in any capacity that really works for everyone.
Thank you. And I know, Petra, you had your hand up a little while ago, and I saw you. I just wasn't able to get to you, but did you have something you wanted to say?
I think I just, like, when I spoke at the rally for educators, I think since it was educators, my goal was to make them have them, like, change their curriculums, because that was their role as educators, to teach students, and the curriculums I set, from my experience, it wasn't helping me become a leader that I wanted to be. So that's what I told educators. So I think that for us, for town, for government officials and town council members and people who are responsible for governing and like helping show leadership as Amherst, as an Amherst community. I think that our role is a more of, I'm not actually sure. I don't know much about government, so I don't know exactly what our role is. It's mostly, I think mostly with like policy, I think. I don't know very much, but having those discussions about like what is our responsibility to the community, and like so with educators, like what is our responsibility to the students, and what is our because they are the community that we're serving. I think that's important. So like hearing the stories of P-Town members and civilians and people in the community is so important to know like what is missing and how we can move forward. And I think a part of that for like for the government is a lot about making ourselves available and in ways that are effective and not just saying, okay, we're available, but no one's coming to us. Like maybe we need to go to communities and try to use our talents and our commitment, our connection to the community to like make that change that we want to make and make sure that our leadership as governing officials, we can make sure that they know that the government is working for them, because that's what we were elected or hired to do. And so I think that's what I would say to governing people, because that's what we're supposed to do.
Is there any interest in expanding the role of our community outreach officers? I know that we have three wonderful people who are reaching out to community members. I know that according to when we're looking at the charter, part of the logic behind that was to both encourage people to serve on committees and be involved in town government, but to also just make sure that we were getting involvement from all members of our community. Is there room, and if there's a cost to it, is there room in the budget to expanding that role?
Human Rights Commission.
Pat DeAngelis was looking to speak.
I like the idea of expanding the role of the community outreach officers, but in the past year, I've learned something else around that. When we were trying to get the DPW put in an area in Amherst, we sent the community outreach officers and staff members to talk to the residents. And we got called out, rightfully so, in a meeting of that community, that we should have come to speak and talk and knock on doors. So I think that, Padua, it seems important to me that you're asking us to figure out what our goals are. And I feel like I'm being asked to actually enter into the community physically, virtually, one-on-one in small groups. So I'm sort of not at a loss, but I just have so much going on about what meetings could be and everything. But I need to get grounded in, I need to talk to people in ways and places where it's safe for them, which means I need to move out. And I won't get a raise, so it won't affect the budget. And I think that one of the things that all the counselors need to find a way to do that and make that commitment. But at the same time, we're all at different levels of understanding, and we have our own work to do. In some ways, we're trapped by public open meeting law rules, because what we need to do, the 13 of us, I think, is really find ways to talk about what we've internalized and where we're coming from in ways that are safe. And I'm taking up a lot of space, which I was not going to speak, so I'm going to get quiet now.
Without giving a legal opinion, I would suggest that your the open meeting law is again focused on what we do in our official roles as, you know, the Human Rights Commission or Town Council. Now, I know that that's tricky for town councilors because the charter calls on you to have meetings with your constituents twice per year, I think it is, in large groups or something like that. But during having a conversation as a human being is something that you're probably also able to do with having multiple town councilors present as human beings. Having conversations is probably also something that would be permissible if it leads to your deliberation as a town councilor. That would be a different issue.
Right.
And so I imagine that you're going to get an opinion from the town attorney on what that could look like. Right. But you know, we are very excited at the idea of getting conversations started. The problem that we've got is, you know, we are a component of the town ourselves. So any planning that we do, we require the support of the town. We need the space, like the Zoom space, mm-hmm. to record. If we're going to record something, to record it. If we're not going to record it, we're going to open it up for conversations to be able to do that. And once we've set it up so that we don't have to make any other decisions or deliberate, but we're just letting people speak, then as many of us who want to be there can be there, because we're not going to be deliberating as the Human Rights Commission. We're just creating that space for people to have the conversation. That's my view of it. It is not advice being given to you. But I think there should be room for that. I have to say that. But we're looking to hear from you how we can both plug in and support. And this deliberation is part of our open meeting. So, you know, if you can let us know, and you're speaking to us, you know, what you think. And Amilcar is also, I think it's actually Deborah who's been waiting to speak as well.
Oh, no, I don't. I'm just listening. Yeah.
Okay.
No, it's
all right.
It's not.
I'll lower all hands. All right. Then Lynn, if you could speak.
First of all, thank you for making me aware that there was this meeting tonight. I don't try to go to all the committee meetings of the town. One of the things that I think is most important for the Human Rights Commission and for others who have been involved in this is in fact what Sid was talking about way in the beginning, and that is to help other people who do not feel comfortable coming to come forward, but to help them make sure their voice is heard in whatever discussion. And to me, that is one of the things that each of us has to do, but some are in better position to do. So I'm one of these people who was always trying to figure out how I can take what I heard and start moving the ball along. And so just what the town council can do is make policy or change policy, and we can approve budgets or ask for changes in budgets. That's really what we do, okay? What the town manager does is run the town on a day-to-day basis, including overseeing the police. And if we want to bring about change, I think we need to both understand what the police are doing by asking the kinds of questions that Gazit Kayan was addressing last week. I found that whole session incredibly informative. And I think we have a lot more to learn. But once we learn, then we need to understand what is desired and how to make that work in, I hate to say it, a bureaucracy otherwise known as the town of Amherst. And that means changing budgets. It means changing, negotiating different stuff in personnel contracts. It means changing policies. And that's our job. But the job we really need is to understand and hear so that we know what we are supposed to do. And that's what we need the Human Rights Commission for and the other people who have been involved in this conversation. And in the process, yes, each of us needs to make our own commitment to understand the issues at the kind of level that Deborah and Barbara have been doing with the group that they have formed. But my job is to also then keep my eye on the ball of where are we going with this, because we do budgets every year, we do policy all the time. And if we want to make changes, we have to understand what's there and what we need to change. And we need you to help us understand what we need to change. That makes sense.
Yep. Gazit Kaya. Can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, great. Sorry about that. So just to Lynn's last comment, I was going to say, I think that another job of the town councilors is to explain to the public what policies are currently in place and what policies are having the opportunity to be created. Because as a person who's been living here for 15 years, I didn't even know there was such a thing as, like, I was vaguely aware of concepts of democracy, but I didn't know that there was like individual policies or that there were town councilors that I could go meet. And if I went to meet with them, I'd have no idea what to ask for or what to tell them I wanted, because I wouldn't know that I even had the right to have that conversation. And, you know, the first town councilor like district meeting I went to, Shalini and Darcy handed out 3x5 cards and said, like, what are your questions? And the only question I could think of was, what are we going to do about racial profiling? Because that was something that I just heard people talk about in my life as like a problem in Amherst. And I didn't know, and I still don't understand, like, how can I say it's really hard to live here because rent is so expensive? How can I say, like, it's really hard to get to the grocery store on the bus? And sometimes I've tried to say some of those things and I've been told, like, oh, well, that's PVTA and it's regional and it's not us. Or, oh, that's I went to the Affordable Housing Trust and they said, oh, we really don't know what to do about that because people get to charge whatever they want for rent. So I feel like there's an element to which you all like get the information about what is a policy that the town of Amherst has. And we aren't educated in that information in such a way that would allow us to advocate for ourselves. So there's gotta be a component, whether it's through increasing community participation officers or instituting some like consistent resident education that's not in the format of like a 3-hour meeting at night with no childcare and no food that is not on the bus line. You know, that to allow us the empower us to participate.
I totally accept what you're saying and understand. Government is complicated stuff, but what I'm saying is, if we can, as a council, understand what the police are presently doing, and we, as a council, listen to what the residents need to be done, then we have the job of trying to figure out how to bring about that change with policy and budgets. So we're not asking you to understand every little nuance, but we need to understand what you want.
Oh, can I just say that I, so because I was not, I haven't always been a town employee, and there is a big discrepancy between being a town employee and a resident of Amherst. And then the things that happen in town, you don't necessarily know about that unless you're raised or around in a culture where people are involved in town. So that is something that as a community participation officers, I mean, I used to try and tag on with LSSE to go to their events, trying to get to the parents from the kids when they were doing things. But some of those people just don't know, and they don't understand, as Gazit was saying, that these things are available. And fortunately, there's a lot of folks out here that don't even know there's a Human Rights Commission. So all of these things, like how to get the word out and how to bridge that gap, it's very complicated almost. Like, it's just, you can't just go out and stand a sign and say, hey, like, if you want to know about town government, I'll let you know. That doesn't mean anything to anybody, right? So it's kind of like, and we can talk about this at our, excuse my dog, the next community participation officer meeting, how we can try and improve that, or what steps that we can do to try and go back to rebuilding. And I think we kind of had some good ideas going on, and then pre-COVID, and then COVID came, and then everything has just completely stopped. Not that that's the only reason, but I think we were on to the next, you know, trying to move forward and couldn't move anywhere, actually. So things are starting to open up now, and people are feeling a little more comfortable. And as Gazit said, and I know, like, as a single parent, like, you can't go places where there's, it's at dinner time and there's no food for your kids that you had to bring, who are sitting on the floor coloring. So all of that stuff is a big impact on the community meeting, you know, connecting with the local government.
And I'd add one thing, which is that, you know, we as the Human Rights Commission, we had a plan that we came up with in November, which was to focus in the 2020 year on anti-racism education. And, you know, we were going to meet mid-March, and we basically, since our last meeting, February 27th to June 4th, we are were unable to meet with each other to discuss these issues, to move them forward. There are very good reasons for a body that has to plan a budget to focus on questions of budgeting, a body that's got to be concerned about negotiating jobs for next year and trying to figure out how to keep stores open, to focus on shops being open from a revenue perspective, on bringing in the taxes on that, but also from a maintaining a sense of community perspective. But as far as moving forward with anti-racism, some of the plans that we had, and if you look at our February 27th meeting, you'll see that we said, who should we bring in next for our conversations? We listed Julie Fetterman, we listed Chief Livingstone as people that we were gonna work with to try to expand community for both for us and for our hope of expanding community education in anti-racism. We're now behind the eight ball in that we're trying to respond to it as a component of the town. But again, we've only come back to this conversation as a group in the last 2 weeks. And we would have loved to have been able to continue the discussion throughout and perhaps be in a better place now, but we are where we are right now. Bless you.
I forgot to unmute me.
That's all right. That's all right. All right. I'll mute you. It's fine. Okay. Just want to give people a chance to speak. But you know, right now we're looking for some kind of help from the people who are elected to have those constituent meetings that are part of the town charter, and try to figure out if that's kind of the space where we begin to reach out to people. Is that where we have an opportunity for grassroots outreach and meeting so that we could actually allow for conversations when you schedule a constituents meeting that is specific to dealing with issues of race. That's something that maybe isn't a policy that is specific, but we've been dealing with those policies when we supported the sanctuary bylaw, for example. One of the things that we had to do was figure out, well, what is the impact going to be on the police? And so we had community members come in to us, talk with us about it, and work on it, have us engage in working on it, and then come together with a policy that the police could agree to, that was acceptable to members of the community, and that the select board was able to support, that we could move forward with. And so the question is, how do we now open up the conversation so that we hear all of those voices, which I will again say that as someone who was on the League of Women Voters committee studying the town charter, one of the goals was that a smaller number of elected officials would have to do all of the homework. The concern that people like Andy and Alyssa had was that those of us who were on town meeting hadn't done all of the homework, and therefore were voting against things that the select board that was there year round knew was going to be good for the town. And that therefore, if we had people who could focus on what the policies really should be year round, not to put words in their mouths, but that those people could help the town reach conclusions more quickly, and would hear more voices because of their accountability to their constituents in a way that town meeting lacked accountability. So the question is, now that we're trying to develop a process, what process would you like to have us work with? We would love to try to be supportive of that process, but we don't have the outreach to kind of amplify all of those voices and reach all of those voices the way that the town councilors do.
I'm more than glad to continue the conversation, but we're not going to answer that question in one meeting. I'm just not. Pat DeAngelis and I are the District 2 councilors, and I certainly don't speak for Pat, but I've gotten to know Pat. And if we could hold a District 2 meeting that was focused on racism and knew that there would be people there who were knowledgeable about the issue and the community's feelings, we would hold the meeting tomorrow.
Do it.
Absolutely. But I will tell you right now, that's not who comes to the meetings. And so we need to figure out how to get that voice to those meetings. And that's what I was listening to this tonight and hearing people saying, how can we, meaning all of the people here, get those voices heard so that we can have the conversation? That's what we need. That's what we need from you all.
Yeah, it's a lot of like legwork, right? That we don't usually do. And I mean, personally, I'm okay with that. Kind of like that thing, but it's a lot of hands-on out in the community work that more than just town council, more than the HRC, and more than the CPOs need to do. I mean, it needs to be a bigger body, because there's such a large space to cover, right? And there's so many different groups to cover, not groups, but individuals of different ethnicities and capabilities and abilities.
So I know Shalini and Pat have had their hands up as well. And so I want them to be heard, and then Gazit Chaya as well. I also want to point out that it's getting a little bit late in the evening. I had asked that we recognized 2 hours and 10 minutes from 6, and we thought we were going to be able to start, and technology did not cooperate. But I also want to at least talk about a process for moving forward with the Civil War plaques and make sure that we are moving forward in support of Juneteenth tomorrow. Yay, Juneteenth. And the Frederick Douglass, what to the slave is the 4th of July reading. So there's a few more things for us to do, but Shalini, if you would speak, and then Pat, and then Gazit Hai, and then Deborah.
Okay, so I think I've learned, I've got a couple of new things that I've learned today. And Gazit Hai, I thank you for bringing up that idea of education using, and we've been having district meetings regularly and we're looking for topics. And I think that's a great idea that we sort of tried to do that, but we can have more focus where we use the district meetings to educate people and get feedback on specific topics. Like we can just talk about affordable housing. These are the policies that are in place in the government right now or in town council or in our town. And so I think that could be one avenue. The other thing I'm hearing again is that we need to coordinate. So when HRC is having a meeting, then we need to know, and we district councilors have lists, email lists that we can send out to people. And then when we're having district meetings about certain topics, we could be sending them out to you. So that's why having a steering committee of sorts where the key people are in, and then we spread out the information and receive information and share that, is one thing that's coming to mind. The other thing very quickly is that I feel we need to have a conversation after we've had with the police, because it is a systemic issue. And as Petua mentioned, that it's, you know, the inequities that exist in school, maybe they exist in the business world or housing. And so again, looking at and getting people's lived experiences, understanding from that is important and a conversation to be had in the future. But I think right now having this focus on having the town hall meeting with the police chief, with the town manager, and then also having those affinity groups, I think that's an immediate kind of thing that I think we can focus on. Thank you.
Thank you. Pat?
She's muted.
Thank you. I don't want to sneeze again, I have allergies. I'm involved with a community group that has created a mobile market and gotten a grant to bring it to Amherst as part of, the originators were Healthy Hampshire. This is a grassroots organization. The direction, et cetera, for the market and what's going to be happening has risen up from the people who are there. And what Gazit Haya is saying makes this group possible because we do it at lunchtime and we provide lunch. We have childcare and transportation. And that's something that, yeah. And so I think that we need to, Lynn and I, as our district meeting, but also for town council meetings, we may need to begin to think about that and find a way to budget funds for that work and for that food. And that's all I have to say. And I'm grateful for your allowing me to attend the meeting. Thanks.
Thank you. I believe, Deborah, you had your hand up as well.
Yeah, I'm going to have to leave the meeting, but thanks for having me here. And boy, I just love that last idea about having a meeting that deals with the issues of childcare and getting people to a meeting. It could make a huge difference, I think. But
translation. That's the other thing we provide, translation.
Yeah.
Sorry.
But Bridge for Unity, we'd love to help in any way we can. And so please feel free to contact me, because Itaya has my email and such. So thanks so much.
Well, thank you.
Thanks for coming, Deborah.
Sure.
Itaya.
Yeah, so just another reminder about the rest of our agenda, and if we wanna, I know we've talked about a lot of different versions again, and in light of that, I have heard consistently people want something to be done within the next chunk of time before our next meeting could happen. Is there something that we could, it sounds like the town councilors are willing to have a town hall to open up. It may be not the long-term vision that we have, but it could be something that could be offered to the community. And would we be willing to co-sponsor that with them? And then would we like to set about an effort to have a few trial affinity groups, knowing that, again, it may need to shift depending on response?
So I guess there's a question of whether that is a particular motion, right? Whether you've moved that that we you know, support the use of town councilor constituent meetings to allow these conversations, and that we as the Human Rights Commission will try to share with our networks when those are occurring, so that there's room for those conversations to at least begin to occur through the town council constituent meetings. And then second, no?
No, sorry. Yeah, I was making a motion that we co-sponsor a specific town hall, not in addition to their regular constituent meetings, not like under the context of their regular ones. That would be for the entire community to address.
All right, I'm a little bit unclear then, because you know, there's the different districts, and so I'm not sure if you're talking about having like a really huge kind of town council town hall discussion with all of the town councilors, all 13, or if we're talking about supporting, you know, for District 2, Lynn and Pat, saying they're going to set up a specific conversation in their district in the first instance about, and have it be geared towards discussions around race and representation and being able to live safely, in Amherst, and hear from constituents there, but us kind of amplifying that request that community members go out to those meetings, because those are two different events.
Yeah, I don't think it matters whether we do like in the districts or a big one, but I'm just thinking that that should be done above and beyond what they're doing in specific response to what's going on in the community right now.
Yeah, I'm happy to let one of the town councilors speak to that, but I think. You know, I wasn't suggesting that we just say they're having a meeting, go if you're interested, and be heard by your town councilors, and that we'd promote that, but rather that if the town councilors are saying, I'm going to have a constituent meeting on this topic, I would like the Human Rights Commission to notify their networks, because I really do want those voices to come out. That I'm not hearing, so that we can move forward. But so am I getting closer to getting the motion right?
I think my motion is, let's plan a meeting, open it up to the community for community questions, so a listening session, like in other words, a town hall. Let's have a town hall. And let's be co-sponsors with the town councilors. And it would be for all of those questions that came in during the meeting with the police chief, and for any and all question. And it could be a starting point so that we can leave this meeting with something.
I open that to the town councilors to speak. I am concerned that you might feel the need to punt if it's something about the police chief, which Lynn, you've just noted, you do not specifically oversee the police department. You oversee the budget for the police department and the and policy issues that might come up in relation to.
Through the town manager, our police chief and his staff have expressed strong interest in participating in a meeting like this. They're more than ready. They've even given us a couple dates, and the real issue is for us to come up with a good format that allows voices to be heard.
So perhaps even if we can, like I did make a motion, I'm wondering if I could hear from anybody else on the commission other than Matthew?
Deborah's trying to speak.
Yes.
Deborah knew.
Can I just ask a question? Because I feel like these are, and I might just be misunderstanding you, Guzzi, Taya, that it seems like there's the listening session with the police, but then there's also an open forum on race in our town. And those are two different, I mean, in my mind, those are two different town hall listening sessions. So yeah. I'm not sure which you're proposing.
I'm proposing the one that's an open listening session.
Right.
Not a discussion with the police, but that it would be an opportunity for people in our community to come together and talk about what they're experiencing right now.
Right. Yep.
Ben?
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, I support that idea and like within the context of like, so that it's not an issue for the town councilors, you know, we would have less than 6.5 of them present so that they could speak freely. That's just my 2 cents on that.
Thank you, Ben.
So was that a second or was that just a comment?
Deborah.
That was the preface to my second. I second it as well.
Can I also ask, is there anything, Matthew, that prevents the Human Rights Commission from taking the lead on hosting that open forum that Guzzi Taya is suggesting? Do we need the town council to necessarily take the lead on that, or are we technically allowed to do that?
So as far as creating space, again, we're a town body, so we would be asking for whether we're doing it through a Zoom webinar, whatever structure we want to put in place, we could do that as long as we have town support to do it. As the point that I raised in our June 4th meeting was, whatever conversation we have, whatever listening session we have, you can choose to have something where people are in community with each other and they just express how they feel. You can also choose to have something where that expression is heard by someone who can act on it immediately. And the question I posed on June 4th was whether we really wanted to make sure we could organize something with those who would be able to act and respond. And that's one of the reasons that I wanted us to look at the kind of discussions that the schools had as one example, and the discussion with the police chief as another example of people who are trying to allow for conversations to happen with the schools, and to ask questions and try to get information and express concern with the police chief. Those are two different models. And I am agnostic on what we do, as long as we are educating and helping people. And I think if we just set up a listening session where we're not really saying anything, but we're letting people speak, then we need someone who would be able to facilitate that, so that we're making sure that the voices are being fully heard. If we do that with the town council such that they are hearing what those concerns are, I don't think that that's a bad thing, because I think people view them as, no offense to us, a lot of people have no idea who we are. They voted for their town councilors, and they have some idea who they are, and they believe that their town councilors are responsible for and accountable to them. And so I think it has a different feel, but it depends on what you want to do.
So if we go back to what Dr. Shabazz was saying, it really depends on what our goal is. If our goal is policy change, then in my mind, we would want to have a series, like a series of many listening sessions, because policy flows out of understanding, right? So it's not going to be like we're going to set up a listening session and boom, we're going to get to policy change. We're going to need a series of listening sessions where voices can be articulated and heard and understood, and then the town council is able to chew on that and translate that into policy change and bring that back to the community. Is this what you said? Is this what you meant? And so to me, this is like a year plan. This is like many listening sessions stacked up one after another, where people, and my sense is they probably will start small, as Jennifer said a while ago, and they will grow because, you know, as people feel heard. And then the other idea is that the goal is within the community, more at the grassroots level, that there is understanding amongst members of the community who don't share the same lived experiences, right? And again, then I go back to that is a series of many conversations. That is not a one and done. So I guess I would like to propose, this is my feeling, it's 8:40. I've worked all day. I know I'm tired and kind of brain dead at this point, that maybe we set up another meeting and we continue to chew on this in a rapid way. I'm not saying to postpone this for much longer, but I don't know that we're ready to say, this is what it is. This is what we're proposing right now. I would like to see us have, like, start something soon, but have it a long range plan where actually both of those goals could be met. Listening and understanding amongst community members who do not share the same lived experience, and have that witnessed and heard by the town council and those who are in positions of power, and have that translate ultimately into policy change.
So process-wise, where we are right now is that there's a motion on the floor that has been made and seconded, which is specific to creating a particular meeting with town councilors to hear from voices in the community. I'm not entirely sure how that is structured, and therefore I imagine that there must be some kind of delegation of someone who, if it's going to happen prior to our next meeting, who would be able to talk with town councilors about what that would look like. But the vote is whether we would support such an event prior to our next meeting. Am I correct that that's the motion?
Yeah, and I think that the town councilors are capable of seeking out a facilitator.
Okay. Shalini, you wanted to speak to this before we take a vote, is that correct?
Yes. Just a suggestion that firstly, I think it would be great to co-sponsor it, because Gazikaya mentioned, because it shows solidarity. It gives, people who don't know about HRC get a chance to know about it, because we do have access to more people. And it just shows that we're working together. And so that's one. And the second thing is we can say this is one of the many, we don't have to have everything figured out at the outset, but we can at least say this is one of the many conversations we're gonna have, but here is this. So at least we have one thing in place. And I do feel there is a need for people to hear what some of us started to hear in the last conversation from the chief of police. So having him and town manager to be there, but that's totally your discretion. And I think we as counselors are there to support you in whatever ways that you think is going to be most skillful. But I think to mark a date and get that would be great. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. So I don't know now if that means having something with the police chief and town manager or just with town counselors or or what exactly we're looking to do. And I too am tired. It's been a long day.
I think maybe Petua, were you going to say something?
Yeah, I think that I was reading what Al Smith was saying, and I think they were saying that to challenge it for us all to capture how the community members feel in its most raw form, however possible, and then deliver those feeling messages to those who need to hear them as needed. And it doesn't have to happen all at once, and likely shouldn't. And then he said the good points for all of us. I think that I don't think we have, it's late, like we can't like start planning the meeting, the town hall that we want to have now. But I think that I don't think we should be starting with organizing leadership. I think we should, because I've been hearing from a lot of people that we don't know what the community is feeling and experiencing in these times. And that's why I think, because that was saying that it's important to have a town hall to like make sure that the community is heard. And I think the goal for us, knowing who is in the like room today, is it's mostly policymakers and council members. And I think that I think policy is where the people in the room today are like have the most power to make change, and we don't really have that connection with the community. So I think that the town hall should be about hearing what the community has to say to make the policy changes or to think about our next steps afterward. That's what I think is what's going on.
Thanks, Petua. I agree. Not a time for responses and specific actions, but just a listening time.
All right. So do we support, therefore, just arranging with the town council to co-sponsor this type of event? And therefore, who is going to kind of get confirmation of what the dates are and be able to explain the format so that we can share that with our networks so that they actually do show up and so that their voices are heard and so that everyone can hear from the community. To go to Amilcar Shabazz's point earlier, I don't know that we are aware of what the number of people would be and what the interest would be. But, you know, is there a need to do follow-up with town council so that we can actually just get it done and reach out to our own communities?
So can I just say, because I've kind of heard like, I'm not quite sure why we just don't have like an open forum and let people just come and speak and then take that and bring that to the counselors and then have another meeting at another time with the counselors there and then another time, another meeting with the police chief, if that's how it goes. But if we just start off with just the HRC having this meeting, trying to open up to the community, and this is no disrespect to the counselors by far, because, you know, you guys are wonderful. I don't know that everybody, like some of the people who I have in mind who would be very good, who we need to hear their voices from, or I think we should hear their voices from, don't necessarily know about the town councilors. So like, and they don't necessarily know about us, but we have to start somewhere, right? Like we have to grab these people. Not, well, I don't mean to sound like that. We need to somehow
hug them in,
welcome them in, right? With open arms so that we can get what is needed and then move like slow, not slow, but then move to the next step. Like, we just don't know. I mean, if counselors want to be there, that's fine. But I don't understand why we can't just say, okay, on this date, we're going to have this open forum meeting. And yes, somebody does need to facilitate that. I'm not saying that they don't, but I think this is a wonderful opportunity for the HRC to get out and be involved in their community.
Is there Deborah's, a negative? Okay, I'm sorry.
To please. Deborah's question earlier, I think we can just schedule a Zoom meeting for that, right?
Is there a harm to us doing it in conjunction with the town council?
There's no harm in it, doing it with the town council. I'm just saying that this is a great opportunity for the HRC to get out and be involved in their community.
I actually really like that idea too, because it just is easy. We schedule our HRC meetings. I don't know if we're going to do another 2-week meeting or a 4-week meeting, but we are a smaller group. The Human Rights Commission wants to hear from you. Please, you know, like to just use our own meeting as an open forum on race, a discussion of race in Amherst. What is your experience? We want to hear from you. Is that what you're suggesting, Jennifer?
Yes.
I love
that. That gives us a little bit of an idea of how everybody works in. And again, I'm not saying that the council doesn't need to be there. They're more than welcome to be there. I'm just saying, why can't we just throw out, it'll make it a little bit easier as finding dates and so forth.
But. I love it.
And they can come to listen, you know, but not to like manage it.
Right.
It's a little more personable that way, I think. I just feel like people might be a little more comfortable.
I also think it is the like kind of the natural place for this initial discussion to take place. And once we do start to hear from community members, that we might get more ideas for hosting either larger or different kinds of events. Looks like Ben wants to say something.
Yeah.
So should we like have a new motion rolling here?
That end? Yes, I'm getting hangry. Let's go.
I second your new motion.
Whatever it is.
Again, I'm just managing a meeting here. And so if you give me the motion and I put it out, someone seconds, we vote. That's all I do.
I think we've got a motion to have a HRC sponsored open listening session where town councilors are welcome to come. And I second that motion.
Okay. Right, so that was Ben. You made the motion. Somebody else to
second. I second.
Okay. All right. Okay.
I was taking Ben as the first motion maker.
Okay.
That's a super efficient way to have a motion and a second.
Yeah. So I don't know that we necessarily are going to get more people coming to something that is meeting with HRC than meeting with HRC and town council, but.
Before we get sidetracked, could we just vote on it?
I was saying that's the motion we've got, so I'm going to ask for a vote on that motion. All in favor?
All right.
All opposed? Abstentions? All right. Then we will plan to do that. We are going to ask the town for help with facilitation if we're going to try to make sure that they're we're encouraging voices to be heard. We are going to invite, I understand, town councilors to be present, but this way we're gonna try to work on something that is a date that we can make at the very least.
Yep, and I also just think that, and again, no disrespect to the councilors when I say this, but I'm not looking at this as like they can bring more. I'm looking at a different group of people actually, because it's a different group of people that we're trying to get. And it's kind of complicated or too complicated for me to really explain in the next 30 seconds. Cause again, I'm getting hangry, but it's a different group of people that we're trying to welcome. Yep. Like when I go out and work with LSSC, it's a different group of people that I'm trying to attract than it is when I'm trying to recruit for, you know, when I'm in boards and committee meetings. Like it's just a different group of people, and we need them and we need their voices, and they are the ones that are being more affected and the ones that are less likely to report because they don't know who to report to, they don't know how to report, or they're scared to report. So that is the group that I'm trying to grab. I don't know about anybody else, and I don't mean to grab like we can just grab people, but you know what I'm trying to say. Like,
can I just say one thing? Whenever.
Sure, Shalini.
I just want to say that I'm not offended at all. That we're, in fact, I would suggest that this be just a community gathering and not have any counselors. Because then, if it is intimidating or, you know, and it is, I know it is for some people that having any kind of this level of involvement. So let's keep this really just a community thing with none of us officials there, so everyone feels safe. And then you will be there to tell us afterwards what are the next steps, whether people want to speak with us, whether they want to speak with the police, whether they want us, you know, whatever comes out of it, we're here, ready and willing. And no offense taken, I think it makes complete sense. Totally respect that.
Okay. As far as making sure that we're getting a facilitator and choosing a date,
I'm on it. That's
okay, Jennifer. and you can communicate to all of us. Yes. We just cannot deliberate together.
Yes, respond individually to me.
Yes, as to whether we can make that date and whether we have any individual concerns, not as a commission, that you can take into account when speaking with the rest of the commissioners. All right. I think that we are going to have to move off of the topic of the conversations at this point. There were three other things, although one was ways that we can engage in leadership at this time. And I think this is one of the things that we're doing. So I'm going to take that off for right now. And that leaves the Civil War plaque statement proposal and upcoming events. I'm also wondering if there are comments that need to be made with regard to the Civil War plaques statement proposal. I was going to ask about what it means for us to pledge full support, what it would mean for us to call this as part of reparations to the African American families in our community, just what these things mean. That's going to take at least a few minutes for us to discuss if we're going to do that right now all together. I really appreciate Gazikaya working on this and pulling something together for us to look at. There's a question of whether it would make more sense to kind of gather, kind of track changes or something in a document with questions so that we are focused specifically on if it's something that one person cares about, nobody else cares about, we can just move off of it fairly quickly. But there's a question of whether we should wait on this statement or whether there's a reason that we need to get to it now because of the historical commission or some other body that is looking at it now. Gazikaya first.
I'm just wondering, it went out already to you all, so does anyone have any specific concerns, or I'd like to make a motion to just, you know, if we're able to just go ahead and pass it because it's a statement, a general statement of support.
Well, right now it says pledge full support of the installation and long-term maintenance and public display. I don't know if there are other ways for us to have, I know that this marble thing was made. I don't know if there are better practices today where you would use something that can be out in the rain, can be, that would be relatively cheaper to have up, but that would have the same kind of sense of community and respect as what was made in the 1950s, what was originally commissioned in 1893, but that has been in the town hall since the 1950s at least. Whether we need this particular piece of marble or whether we support anything that would just recognize this community with the same degree of gravitas.
So can I just say that the Civil War plaque committee or commission or whatever we are met today. That's the meeting that I had, the Zoom meeting that went fine that I had before this one. And so there's just a lot of stuff going on there right now. And I think all we're really looking for, and Dr. Shabazz has gotten off, is really just whether or not people are in support of it. It's like, it's not so complicated about the structure. I mean, we have to present that. I mean, I think at this point, it's just whether or not people feel the need for this to come out into the community and do they stand behind that and support that. Then down the line, I mean, I can't see that they would do anything that would make it so people don't support it. I don't, quite understand.
And they're not asking for our opinion on if these are, if this is the memorial that's the most worthwhile for the community. This is a memorial that's already in Amherst, ready to be put up. And they're asking to make sure that it comes to fruition because it's been just sort of lost in the stream of consciousness. Right. And so they're not asking for logistical support. They're not asking for financial support. They're just asking for like an endorsement from us. Like, yeah, we are philosophically and emotionally in support of your effort because it's, all the logistics and finances are handled by the town. And they're not asking us to do something on that front.
And as long as the town believes it has the money to do it and wants to do it, that's
so the fine. Money's coming from multiple sources, and okay. We're not asking for anyone to donate, for the HRC to give any funds. We're just asking for general support of whether or not this is something, which it seems like it would fit in our mission, that we would support, or that you guys would support, I should say.
All right, so I guess Kaya, you have moved that we accept it as is. I would make some just small tweaks, but that's me. I would always do that, no matter, like, even if I had written it myself, I'd look at it now and be like, I'm gonna make some changes. So, was there a second for accepting it as is?
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, that's everybody. That passes, and then we can send that out in support to the committee that's dealing with that. That only leaves then our Juneteenth is tomorrow. Reminder that it starts up at 4:00. If you can sign on, it's channel 12 or watch. It starts up at 4:00 tomorrow. It's supposed to go to about 5:30. And everyone, drive to town hall, be safe and distant, but get your book from Jennifer, because she's got them. And Jennifer, just to check in on what mm-hmm. to the slave is the 4th of July. I understand that there was arrangement of young people who would be doing the reading. Are we moving mm-hmm. forward with that?
We are still going to move forward with that. I can't guarantee that it'll be the young children, the Shabazzes, and we all just need to kind of get over Juneteenth first, and then we will go. I mean, it's a reading, and so I guess there's, we just have to kind of figure what, it's not as complicated as planning a full outblown event, but there is a lot of important work to be done towards it, and which it will get done. And I don't know that we should go another month without meeting. I don't know that that seems very logical at this point. I just feel like with everything that's going on right now, we kind of need to meet a little bit earlier, but I can understand if everybody's schedule cannot commit to that. So either way, I will keep you guys well informed either via meetings or via email.
Okay. I guess one thing, so we've two other things left really quick. First, when we next meet. Do you want to try, I am not available 2 weeks from tonight. I am actually traveling, but it's within Massachusetts, so it should be okay. Do we want to schedule for that date, and someone else will run the meeting?
I can do the Zoom part. Isn't Sid like our vice chair?
Sure.
I think that we can follow the agenda without a designated leader.
And I won't have a password with that.
July 2nd would be the date.
Okay. So July 3rd is a holiday, so people know. That's the observance of July 4th is going to be observed on that Friday. So
okay.
Could be other people traveling too.
So we need at least four, and ideally it would be five of you who are here who would say, yeah, I'm going to be there in order to make sure that we can go forward with it.
It's possible I may have a conflict, but I will do my best.
Okay.
So I mean, so we don't have to meet on a Thursday, right?
Like, should we go to 3 weeks instead of two?
I don't know about 3 weeks, but we could do it a different day if that
earlier in the day might.
No, Deb.
I can't do earlier. No.
Can you do a different day?
I could do a different evening, but I can't do earlier in the day.
Yeah, I got work too, so. What about that Tuesday, the 30th, or Wednesday, the 1st July?
I'm okay any of those days. You guys just let me know.
I'm okay any day that's not a Tuesday. Other than that, I'm impartial, just not.
So Wednesday? What about Wednesday, the 1st?
Yeah, I have a conflict both of those nights, but it's, and then the next week I'm not available on.
So let's go to the week of.
So then we have to, then we just go.
Yeah.
To our regular meeting time.
Yeah. Still.
I mean, I can try to figure it out.
No, we can just wait till the next meeting time. I mean, I can get everything set up for, or as much as I can for the listening session.
Well, and I think the listening session, maybe we could do on a weekend, hopefully, so that it can be more available to everyone. Mm-hmm. And we're just going to go ahead with planning that, right? That's not waiting on our next meeting.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, we've seen a lot of things come together very quickly in the last few weeks. Last 2 weeks since we've met, we've seen a few events come together very quickly. So I think people are getting used to that. All right, then that leaves one other thing. Elizabeth Kahn.
Yes.
Thank you, thank you, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Well, I just thank you for giving me a few minutes here, and I'll keep it short because I know we're all tired and hangry. And so I'm at the end of my 3-year term, and I actually started attending meetings about 6 months before I officially got on the commission. And Matthew knows I've been sort of struggling with this decision for a while, and I'm struggling with it tonight because I always feel so energized and so hopeful. And so like proud of our town that we do these things in this wonderful way. And I'm feeling like, oh, I'm not going to be able to be involved in this particular way with all these great projects. But I promise you, I will continue to be present as much as I can. And the reason I'm going off is really COVID related. My mom is 88 and she's doing well, but she lives in a senior residence and like she can't go out and grocery shop, and I need to, you know, have some time to take on some things that are going to be helpful to her. And in my job at Cancer Connection, where I'm the program director, we've had to move all of our programming onto, you know, remote conferencing, and we're probably going to keep it there for quite a while because we work with folks who have compromised immune systems, and that has just been absolutely flattening me. And I need to be able to really pay attention to that. And I also feel like this is a big equity issue for the kind of work that we do, and I want to be able to do it well. So I particularly want to thank you, Matthew, for kind of like leading from behind, for steering the ship so thoughtfully. And Jennifer, to you, because I think that as a town, we're just so lucky to have you as one of our staff people. And every other person on the commission, I'm not going to take the time, but I really appreciate the way you are connected to your own communities and the beautiful kind of voices and vision that you bring into the space. And I think that's the most important thing that the Human Rights Commission does, is hold the space to make sure that these conversations keep happening. So thank you very much. And I will not be a stranger, but it might be just a little while until I get these other things kind of sorted out, then I can come back and just be a community member participating. So thank you, Matthew.
Take care, thank Elizabeth.
You.
Thank you.
Yay. Thank you. Yes. Look forward to seeing everybody around town with our masks.
Hey, yeah, the meetings definitely run past time. Look at
hopefully
that.
You'll recognize us. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All right, all in favor? All right, great seeing everyone.
Elizabeth, hi.
Thank you for your service. Thank you so much. All right.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
For our visitors, thank you for coming. Our listeners, thank you for listening in.
Yep. Bye-bye.
I should stop recording now, right?
Yeah. Anytime.